meant for an adult audience.
LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Yes, it is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. He is Dr. Drew. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician and addiction medicine specialist. And welcome to another fabulous chapter of the best of LoveLine.
Yes, it really is the best, isn't it, when it's the best?
Yeah. Now, here's the thing that's going to sound a little confusing. We're starting tonight off with Tom Arnold. Now, I know he doesn't sound like the best.
No, he was excellent.
Yeah, I know. You know why? Because he told that story about working at a slaughterhouse shooting pigs.
Yeah.
And his sister being in prison.
Yeah. That's why I like Tom. Really.
That's good times.
Yeah.
Speaking of the best, we got Jimmy Kimmel. My beloved Jimmy Kimmel, the Emmy Award-winning Jimmy Kimmel, will be on here.
Jimmy Kimmel, your life partner?
My partner in ass, Jimmy Kimmel, will be here. Cypress Hill. These are friends of the show, and they get mellower every time we see them because they've smoked 10 kilos more of weed since the last time we saw them.
It's a case in point, isn't it?
Kim Coles is going to come in here and talk about why the blacks hate the Jews so much.
Yeah, I got some feedback on that show, actually.
We got to the bottom of it, finally.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And my neighbor, John Cryer, is going to come in here. You remember Ducky Boy. He's going to come in and talk about what a delight it is living next door to me. Tonight, we'd like to welcome back to the show, Tom Arnold.
Hey.
Good to see you, Tom.
Good to see you guys.
You know what, you know what I like about you, Tom? Always evolving. A real work in progress.
Yes.
You know, every time you see Tom, he's either kicked something or lost something.
Gained something.
Gained something.
Yeah, exactly.
Got out of a relationship, put down a crack pipe, dropped 40 pounds. He's on to something.
Yeah.
And it's nice.
It is nice.
You never know who's going to show
up. Exactly. What I'm bringing. It's all good.
Well, you look good.
Thank you.
You look like you're in great shape.
Oh, I'm in fair shape. Yeah. I mean, good shape for me.
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of exercise, working, doing an hour and a half of cardio every day.
Every day.
Yeah. Dating. Wow. I'm dating. You got to be in shape for that.
Oh,
you know, you got to be in shape to get the date.
Right.
Then you get her locked in.
Yeah.
Then you can gain it back.
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny how you care about looking good for a short period of time in a relationship. And then after that, it's like you're crapping with the door open. And so, honey, I got a zit on my back. Get that paper clip and see if you can get it.
They like doing that, though. Well, half women love that, other half hate it. But the ones that like it, love it.
Yeah, they're like those monkeys that groom the other
monkeys.
They're
collectors, too.
Oh, jeez.
They'll collect the remnants.
Oh, no.
Oh, I've seen it. I've seen it collected and eaten.
Oh!
That's all I'm going to tell you. I'm not going to say who.
Oh.
I'm not going to say who, but it's I've seen it happen.
Oh, my God.
Nuts.
Nobody recent. Let me just put it that way.
Yeah. Yeah. Women love futzing with a guy. And, you know, it's funny. A man wants to touch a woman sexually, but other than that, he don't want a lot of contact with her.
I'm a hugger. I do.
All right, but it's still almost a precursor to sex. But what I'm saying is you're not picking out any blackheads or wiping
Not examining.
No. They don't usually. Do they need that?
There's apparently a fair amount of maintenance that goes on with these ladies.
Is that right?
Men don't really want to be reminded of the fact that it's a biological entity they're talking about. It's a pillow. It's an angel.
Like, I like to look at women as very elaborate, sophisticated, inflatable dolls. You know what I mean? Like, they really got it right this time.
Right.
But you certainly don't want to walk by the bathroom and see some tampon or something rolling around or anything like that.
Right. But, you know, you're the first guy to offer to whip it out of there if you want to get too busy.
Oh, Tom.
Hey, don't worry. I don't mind that, honey.
No, I know.
I'll get a towel. Anyway.
See, Tom's a man.
I am a man, for God's sakes.
Exactly.
What about like when the maid comes around or something?
Well, how about the dog? That's worse. Dog running through the house. What's she got in her mouth? For God's sakes. Tom and company.
You're good for money.
I'm okay for money. Yeah,
and
I'm okay.
And you're working. You're doing movies.
I'm probably not working as much as I'd like to.
But here's the question: Will you ever work as much as you'd like to?
No. Well, you know, there was a time when I worked too much, and that's probably why it's been harder.
Here's the question: could you do two movies a year, have some free time, and sort of relax? I mean,
I could guarantee that I would have two good movies a year. You know, supporting roles in good movies, and then I would probably maybe do a little stand-up. But, I mean, you're a guy that's had you got that one show, and you had that other show, and you got this show, and you got the commercials.
Yeah.
So what's the deal?
What am I talking about?
No, you understand. I mean,
you're right, but I always think to myself, if I could just slide into doing a couple movies a year, I would gladly just stay home.
You think that?
Okay, well, maybe you're right.
No, he would stay home.
Oh, would he?
He is a pain. He asked me to work.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thanks for defending me, by the way.
Work is
hard, though. It is. I like to get the offer, but I don't like to do it.
Right.
You know, like I was glad when you guys called, you know, that sounds great. And then it got closer and closer. And I was like, oh, my God. Why even tonight, I was watching the game and I was going, okay.
You got to pry my ass off the sofa.
All right.
I know. Thank you, by the way. Thank you. Jessica?
Yeah.
You're 18?
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
I have two problems.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, one of them is I know when I get off during sex, but I don't hardly ever.
What'd you say?
She knows when she gets off, but she doesn't hardly ever.
I see.
Rare orgasm, right?
It's like, I've only had, like, a couple.
And you're talking about during intercourse?
Yeah.
Which is...
I don't like somebody, like, going down on me or anything.
Yeah. Well, we'd make a good couple. Why don't you like that?
It's just... I don't know. I talk to my friends about it, and they're like, you are crazy. And it's, I don't like it.
Is it too intense? Too intimate?
No, I just... It tickles.
Yeah, too intense, yeah.
Tickles is sort of too intense, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess.
All right. What if the guy wasn't wearing as much jewelry? I mean, what if he just slowed down a little? Took it easy on you.
I can't handle it.
All right. But you can have an orgasm on rare occasion when you're having intercourse.
Yeah, but it's like not that often.
Do you like to, are you on the bottom usually?
It's like, anyway.
Anyway.
Right. Some people like to be on top and it touches them better.
Yeah. Women can sort of work that area a little better when they're on top.
Mm-hmm.
But at 18, you know, isn't
still working it out?
Aren't you still developing?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so don't put so much pressure on yourself, Jessica.
Find a relationship, somebody you really care about, and you won't be so focused on that, you know, the climax.
Do you have a boyfriend?
Well, kinda. He's like coming back from California. He don't know if he wants to move back or just.
Okay. Here's my point. I bet it'll be easier for a guy to go down on you if you're having a good relationship with the guy.
Or you'll just, again, you won't be, you'll relax, you'll be more involved in the intimacy and some of this
well, I don't have sex that often.
All right. Okay. Maybe you should masturbate, because that's a way, so honestly, that's a good way to get to know yourself, know what you like, you're secure, you know you can make it happen yourself, well, so then you teach the guy.
Tom, you see if you agree with me on this. Is an interesting thing about women is that they the only thing we know how to communicate with women about masturbation is using sort of terms and mechanical descriptions that are suitable to men.
Right.
And women just, it doesn't make sense to them. Could you masturbate, Jessica?
Yeah, but I really seriously don't like them.
It doesn't do anything for them.
Really?
Yeah, they have to be able to connect with an emotional experience that is a sort of an intimate place in order for all that sexual material to sort of function.
Yeah.
And for men, it's like, hey, you put it here, you do this, and it's mechanical, period.
Right. Right.
For women, there's a central nervous system
important. What I call that intimate place where I go to masturbate for myself, I call it earth.
Right.
I don't give a rat's ass where I'm out in the yard or at my parents' house. Doesn't matter.
But that's because you're older. When you get older, because when I was Jessica's age, I was too embarrassed to admit that I did that. I would say, no, my friends, we make fun of each other. Now that I'm 41, I've got a whole system. You know, it's sure. The same video, the towel, half wet, half dry, Astroglide.
Whoa, wow, half wet, half dry.
Half warm water on the one side and dry on the other for the cleanup afterwards.
Nice.
And then, you know, you got, but you, I tell you what.
Oh, Adam,
you get lube on the remote control, you're in trouble.
Yeah.
But so you got to use just the one hand. But it's a whole system, and it really works for me.
Same tape.
Ashley, what's up?
Yeah. You know what? I actually made up my question. I apologize for that, but I'm dying to talk to you guys.
Great.
Okay. I just think you guys are awesome, and I totally admire you for all the time and energy you spend on these callers. It's really cool.
Wait now, Ashley. You heard Adam doesn't spend much energy at all. If he has to spend energy, he starts screaming at him.
Well, that's energy, isn't it?
That's true.
Yeah.
I go to a really small private girls' school, and there's not much information circulating, to say the least. So
where do you live?
San Francisco.
What kind of outfits do you wear there?
Britney Spears outfits.
Oh, really? Seriously?
Yeah, it's pretty bad.
Oh, my God. Talk about just putting out the welcome wagon to the pedophiles and the rapists. You know what I mean? I think you guys should be wearing orange jumpsuits like prisoners. You know what I mean? I mean, you know, I mean, think about it for a second. I know it sounds, I mean, this is a problem, right? There's a lot of young women getting pregnant, being sexually assaulted and stuff. You put them in the pigtails and the plaid skirt and the knee-high socks, and you're asking for trouble.
Are there problems there, Ashley?
Well, not really. It's kind of weird to have these girls with really short skirts and makeup, you know, when it's all girls. It's kind of weird, but no, not really.
Do the girls still get dudded up or primped
for each other?
Yeah,
that's amazing. See, you go to an all boys school, I'd be walking around a pair of sweatpants with an erection or like mustard on it, slippers, you know,
and lunch on your chest.
I mean, forget it. Are you kidding? I mean, why are they getting primped?
I don't know.
Is it in the middle of the city?
Yeah, it's in Pacific Heights.
Right.
But women do compete with other women.
Oh, yeah.
I think. Mm-hmm. And men compete with other men when there's women around or in sports, but not amongst each other when there's no women around.
Right. They're just physically competing.
Eating contests.
Yeah, I mean, they see who can eat the most bacos.
Right.
They do smart things like that. I love that. I had my friends like once. It was great. Like three of them to see how much water they could drink.
Oh, yeah. That's a good one.
In 10 minutes, you know, they all vomited. It was great.
That's great.
You know, it's great. It's great paying guys. Like I have the friend that paid a guy $100 to eat a cube of butter. And he vomited.
Right.
Yeah. It's
paying guys to vomit, basically.
Paying guys will pay guys to torture them. It's great.
Ashley, do you have a question?
No.
Actually, I do have a question.
Oh.
Okay.
The first one is, Adam, I'm just kind of curious, where did you get your working around metal theory?
You mean
around metal?
The men who work around metal?
Yeah, I'm just curious where you got those.
And why I don't trust them?
Yeah.
Well, it's mainly guys, blue collar is a pretty scary way to go with the guys. That's per capita. That's alcoholism and rapists and child abuse and stuff like that. And then even that has a pecking order. And I guess, you know, sort of Finnish carpenter sort of at the top, and it works its way down to welder. And I worked with a guy when I used to do earthquake rehab work. I worked with a couple of welders, and they're the scuzziest guys in the world. Most welders get into welding so that they can fix their motorcycles. They're usually bikers who get jobs at muffler shops. Now I'm not talking about a big chain, Meineke or something, or Midas or something like that, but go to a hole-in-the-wall muffler place and take a look at the dude who's sitting in there with that scraggly beard, and he's got his hog leaned up against the wall, and he's got all his nudie magazines everywhere. And I work with this dude named Russ, and Russ told me the first day I met him, and that's what I like about these guys. The first day I met the guy, he was telling me how he put Pop Rocks in his wife's coos and ate it. And I thought, you know, I've known you for 4.5 hours, and you're telling me how you violated your wife with candy.
Did you ever do that with anybody?
No, I never did the
Pop
Rocks.
I mean, that seems like something that would be in the back of your mind and come up, you know, just happen to have some.
You figure Russ planted the seed.
Exactly.
I was so disgusted by the look of this guy, Russ. He was like toothless and he was scraggly. You know when guys are really skinny and look really out of shape at the same time?
Right.
It's kind of a tall order, but it's really bad. Like super skinny with a gut.
Yeah.
And that was Russ. I hope
did you
listening.
Did you work before?
I worked in a meatpacking plant. Yeah,
that's
a whole different. That's a whole different animal because you know we got guys in there that are, you know, the guys that were in livestock who actually did most of the killing are a different breed than the guys that did the cutting. You know, and they get, you know, it went, you know, it was in Iowa back in Atumwa.
It's like people follow the path of least resistance. They go to the place where they don't feel.
Right.
You know,
right.
We were talking to Kim Cole about this last night. She had some experiences where she couldn't understand why she's going back for some abuse. And it was like, she didn't even notice that she's being abused. She didn't have a feeling about it.
I couldn't imagine working in a slaughterhouse.
I did it three years.
Oh, my God.
No windows. You know, it's 5,000 hogs a day we killed. And you know, they come, you know, just cut them up. But it was the best job in town. Wow. My grandpa worked there 50 years.
same kind of job?
Yeah. 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 I had my nickname was Gunner because my job, if the hog had a broken leg, my job was to shoot it in the head and kill it, you know, put it out of its misery. And so one day there was six of them with broken legs and it was lunchtime. So you're supposed to shoot them one at a time and then hang them up and then cut their throat, you know, like the humane way. And I just shot them all and they went to lunch and they condemned them. they said these can't be used, and that I almost got fired, and then I got the nickname Gunner.
Because they hung out for while
you
wait lunch?
Yeah, you got to cut their throats right away to get that blood out of them because it taints them. As soon as they're dead, they have to be hung up by their back hoof. And they the way they usually kill
them. Same with hookers, by the way.
Exactly.
I don't know if people know that.
People that eat meat should know this, but the way they do kill them, they shock them. And it drops them down.
Oh, they walk onto a grate or something?
They walk onto it, and they put this thing comes on their back with these prods, and it just shocks them, and it knocks them out. Then they hang them up by their back hoof and cut their throat right away. And that's how they kill them.
And when did the shocking part come
in? That's for the humanity, you know, the humane. They used to hit them in the head with a hammer.
Right.
And then a lot of times you'd have to hit them a whole bunch of times.
That's nice.
And that's not good. That's not good. But this way is sort of humane.
Okay, so they do the shock, and that, or they can choose lethal injection.
Exactly.
But they give them the shock, and then you have to slit their throat and hang them immediately.
Immediately.
And what's the average weight of one of those hogs?
About 250 pounds.
Yeah,
okay, so you got to get them up on a hoist or something and bleed them immediately because the blood sits in them for any period of time.
It's screwed up.
Once they're dead, obviously.
They're
condemned. Oh, they're condemned.
They're condemned, yeah.
Yeah, you got to feel good when you're a hog that Tom Arnold just put a 44 slug in your head and you're going out in the dumpster. Nice.
Exactly.
Nice life. Thank God you're here.
Exactly.
So now you got to shoot the ones, or you had to shoot the ones who had a bad leg.
Well, they're broken.
They
were
shocked.
Hurt. Yeah, they couldn't be hung up because their leg was broke. It wouldn't hold by the chain. I mean, it's sad, but you know, that's the way it went. You know, I worked on farms.
What happened to that?
Then I shot them, and then and they were dead. And then we used them for other types of activities, pepperoni for Pizza Hut. We would get these boars in that had been out, like, you know, 1,800 pounds that had tusks, and they'd been in the farmer's fields. They didn't know where they were for years. They bring them in. They're so big and mean. We try to weigh them, and they're so violent. You got to be careful. And one guy had this big bar, and as soon as they'd be knocking people around. They killed a guy once and knocked people around. He'd take that bar. You know,
wait a minute. Did you eat the guy?
No.
Well, they had to. The inspector was coming by.
But this is how crazy these people are that work there. And then, you know, the testicles in the back, he took that iron bar and just give them a little tap, and then it would kind of settle down, and then they could shock them and cut their throats.
Right. Oh, my God. And what would that to me, it's like Vietnam.
It's
like
was
work
hard.
In Vietnam. You go in and punch in at Vietnam.
It was
Ho Chi Minh Trail.
But that's just on the kill floor. If you're in a ham bone or something like that, you don't really see that. You just see the hams. They aren't human. They aren't animal. They aren't alive.
Right. You know? But being down on the floor when they're, you know, especially after, did your mom read you Charlotte's Web when you were growing up?
No, we didn't have to read.
Because
I understand. I've read it.
There's a pig in that.
Yes. Do you eat meat?
Oh, yeah. I used to eat meat. I'd cut a ham would come by. I'd cut a big chunk off and cook it in my meat cleaner. You know, you had a little hot steamer there and eat it, you know.
Whoa. What was the hot steamer? You had a fondue bowl?
Yeah, it's like a big, it's like a cup that's full of hot water that you clean your knife in it. And it's boiling. And you just cut a piece of ham off and put it in
there. Drop it in there.
And eat it, yeah.
Nice.
Mm-hmm. I'm a Jew.
This is why you're scared to not work. You're not Jewish when you're in Iowa. Out of Iowa,
That's true.
No wonder the guy's scared to turn down work. He's back. He's going slopping. He's going to the floor. He's going to do some slitting. All right, one last question.
Yeah.
When you shoot the hog,
right.
Do you shoot it with a pistol?
No, we shoot it with it's a pistol type weapon that has a bolt
a hammer in it, right?
Yeah, it's a bolt that comes out about 8 inches or 6 inches maybe. It goes into right behind the ear,
mm-hmm.
and it immediately, if you do it right,
sure.
You know, you get them down immediately.
It's pissing.
And it just punctures the skull and goes actually into the brain?
Yeah. Now, my sister works there. She got out of prison after 10 years last year, and she's already got a job down there and doing great.
Really?
Yeah, it's a perfect job for her.
Exactly. Well, hold on. No, wait. We got to go to break.
I wonder why it's a good job for her.
I could do another. You know, here's the problem with this show, quite honestly. I get told constantly by the program director, stop talking and start taking calls. But when Tom Arnold comes in here and talks about putting hits on pigs and going to lunch and his boiling pot in front of him and his sister doing time, what are you supposed to do with that?
You got
to
talk.
All right, we'll come back.
Yeah, but see, it's him talking, not you. Okay. That's okay.
How dare you?
Loveline will be right back, so get your problems ready.
This evening, Loveline is brought to you by Car Toys and the Cobalt Lounge, right here on 94.7 NRK, the new rock alternative.
It is the Love Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. We're here with the Emmy Award-winning Jimmy Kimmel, who can be found on The Man Show. Sundays, 10 o'clock on Comedy Central. Jake?
Yeah.
You're 19. What's up?
Hey, that's right. First of all, just saw The Man Show. That X-ray specs thing was great.
Oh, thanks.
It was classic. First thing, hey, Drew, you say that spanking is a form of child abuse.
No. I always ask if the people use an object.
Well,
and that seems to be the threshold issue, that spanking, a single episode of spanking, you're supposed to spank if it's a behavior that you need to have stopped immediately, like walking into traffic or something dangerous.
Swallowing.
And what you'll find is that the literature's shown very clearly.
It bugs me when I'm trying to watch TV.
While spanking will stop the behavior in the moment, mm-hmm. within the next 2 weeks, you'll see increasing truancy and acting out. And if you continue to spank, you tend to sort of string together this truancy, and you end up with a kid who's sort of antisocial. Now, if you then factor in striking with an object, then it becomes a whole different thing.
Well, I don't understand because, you know, I was spanked with a belt, and my sister was, and my parents were, and my grandparents were. And my question is, if we were all, you know, if everybody I know was, you know, was spanked with an object, how come we're not all screwed up?
Well, you ever listen to this show?
Nobody all the time, every night.
Nobody that's screwed up, though, thinks they are screwed up. Exactly. So you could very well be screwed up.
Yeah. We should really talk to some of your coworkers. I'm sure they'd have a whole different spin on this screwed up thing. Plus, you're going through your entire family lineage and everyone beat everyone with a belt.
That's how that happens.
So that's a good... That's you're kind of making Drew's argument.
A case for the cycle of abuse.
But now, what do you have any kids, Jake?
No, I'm too young for that.
You're right. And you're not antisocial or violent.
No, and nobody in my family is.
You don't work around metal or attend junior college?
No, university.
I see. So everything's fine. Listen, it
couldn't hurt to not spank them. That's the way I look at it.
I don't, right. I don't plan on spanking.
What it does, check out, your sister's never been victimized in any way?
No, none of us have. Nobody has.
You know, it just sets you up to be a victim is what it does.
All right. Well,
I have one more question.
Yes, and I want to say this. Yeah. I don't have kids. I've learned a few things from this show. When I do have kids, and I do want to discipline them, and on the off chance I do have to spank them, I don't want them to associate the spanking with me. So I'm working on a spanking machine.
Yeah.
It'll be down in the garage. I'll strap them in, and then I'll leave the room.
Popeye have one of those.
Hey, I got one more question.
I think it was called Brutus.
Can I ask one more thing?
Yes,
real quick?
Yes.
Where did Ace Rockola come from? Where did that happen?
From heaven.
I don't know.
Ace Rockola.
Actually, I was sleeping. I was sound asleep. I was dreaming, and then I woke up, jacked off, and then I thought of Ace Rockola.
Oh, my God.
Just right, a regular day.
All right. Let's talk to Stephanie, who's 16. Stephanie?
Yes?
What's up?
Okay. I went and got tested for chlamydia and stuff last week, and my doctor called and told me I had it, and, like, right after he told me, like, my body started totally changing and, like, started having the typical signs.
Which is what?
Like, unusual discharge.
Okay, all right.
And like,
why did you get tested if you weren't having the symptoms already?
Well, it was just my yearly exam.
Really?
And she's like, I'm just going to do a culture for chlamydia. And so I was like, okay.
Interesting.
Not a big deal.
Do they usually do that?
Huh?
They often do, yeah.
I got tested for Clamato once. It came out quite clean.
But anyways, so the doctor said, you know, you need to call the guys you've been with and let them know.
Sure.
And so...
Really? Really? Did you do it?
Yeah.
Oh, please. I would never do that.
No, I wouldn't either.
What good is it going to do them?
They need to get treated.
Oh.
Exactly.
But if you don't know, how bad could it be?
You can infect many other people.
Yeah.
If this is the kind of thing that just nobody ever even realizes it, I mean, how bad is it? What happens with this chlamydia?
You become infertile.
Uh-huh.
Oh, really?
Leading cause of infertility.
Oh, well, we should have more of it then.
Yeah, that's a good point. But
listen, everybody's worried about all this. Yeah, you just put something in the water. We wouldn't need the condoms or anything.
And oftentimes women do not know they have this, and it's the years of smoldering infection that causes the infertility.
Hmm.
That's why they screen for it regularly.
Stephanie?
Yes?
So have you called everybody?
Two of them.
How many more are there?
Two.
Do you have their phone numbers?
Yeah.
Oh, it would be great if we could call them, wouldn't it?
No, yeah.
That wouldn't be good.
You sure?
I'm positive.
I think it would make it easier for you and humorous, and they'd get probably a charge out of it.
Yeah. And who better to find out from than Dr. Drew?
Yeah. The man is a doctor, right?
Come on.
No, I'm sorry.
All right. All right, so what's your question?
I read up that you can get PID, pelvic inflammatory disease.
Right, right.
And I'm wondering how, like, what are the odds of me getting that?
Well, you were treated.
Not yet. Well, I haven't gotten my pills yet.
Why don't you go get treated? Because the longer it stays in you, the higher the probability that it's going to get into the tubes and cause PID, okay?
Yeah.
All right, yeah, but she'll be all right. She hasn't had it for long. I mean, no. Some people have it for years.
Yeah.
You can tell the other two guys?
Not yet. I was going to call them tomorrow.
You know, tomorrow?
That's very brave.
What did the other two say?
The other two, one of them just totally flipped out and started yelling and screaming
really?
At me. Yeah.
You see, here's what you need to do. Call and scream at them. You gave me chlamydia.
Right.
Get my doctor tracked it to when, and you know, yeah, exactly. That's what you do.
By the way, how dare he yell and scream like that? That's part of the, if he wasn't wearing a condom, that's the risk he takes.
Yeah, but if you think about it, I get mad when people give me a cold, even though, you know, it's like, oh, yeah, great, I got your cold.
Yeah.
You know.
Stephanie, though, you must have gotten it from somewhere.
Well, I have a feeling I know who I got it from because it says it takes like 2 to 3 weeks to show up.
Right.
And I've only been with one guy since then.
Did you call him yet?
Well, I did, and he wouldn't talk to me.
Yeah.
And he doesn't even know about it. So his mom's like, well, can I give him a message? I was like, yeah, tell him he gave me chlamydia.
Oh, that's nice.
Nice.
That's just short of the singing telegram at work.
Yeah.
You told his mom?
I was very proud of myself, yeah.
No, that's not so great. That's a little, I mean, I'm proud of you for stepping up and telling the partners and being responsible, but telling them, well, I was a little aggressive.
Not only
well,
that,
he hung up. Maybe he didn't want to talk. Yeah.
Oh, he wouldn't talk to her?
He refused to talk to me.
Oh, well.
Maybe he's mad at you for giving him chlamydia.
He gave her chlamydia. And by the way, I would have called him first and said, listen, here's some numbers of some guys you've got to call. Because you got the whole thing started.
Wait, by the way, you're 16. How many guys have you been with?
My vagina was merely a middleman.
Why so many guys in such a short period of time?
It's been like 2 years.
All right. That's not bad.
4 guys.
That's pretty good.
Not even close to my friends, so I'm rather pleased with that number.
Okay. All right. Hang in there. Be careful.
Yeah,
condoms, right?
Oh, yeah.
Wear them on your head, even. Couldn't hurt.
All right, Stephanie.
Just as a reminder, right?
Good luck. Oh, that must have been great with Mom on the other line.
See, those are the calls you should record, because when you're 60, you're going to want those, right?
Someday. We're going to get those calls?
Oh, no, no. No. We aren't. Drew, of course we aren't. These people are savages if this goes on.
Drew, this is where my cyanide tablet comes
in.
You
hear about this? I want you to have this. It's a gift from us.
Well, we had a guy call in last week. He was like 16. He pulled an all-nighter. He met some guy at a gay club. He brought him home. And his mom walked in, you know, opened the door to his bedroom at like 8 in the morning on a Sunday morning. The kid was performing fellatio on himself. While the guy he picked up was basically masturbating on the bed next to him. And I said to Drew that you should, as a parent, keep the cyanide pill. Keep it in your cheek all the time.
Yeah, way back.
But when you knock on the kid's door, this is after puberty, you slide it in between your two back teeth.
Just as you walk through each time.
And if you ever see him performing fellatio on himself and a guy in a leather vest jacking off, you just chomp down on it. No questions asked. You don't even have time to process it. It's like a Nazi war criminal living in Argentina, you know?
This is our gift to you, Jimmy. It sounds like a nice thing.
You see the Jewish underground coming up the driveway? You just bite down on that thing.
Yeah.
You know it's going to be just years of torture and torment. You probably get hung at the end of it. You just keep that.
Yeah.
Start marketing
it's not a bad
this.
Idea.
No. Yeah, I mean, you guys don't need it yet. I'm saying in a few years. Well, you know what would be a better idea? You guys should just move out. You know, when your kids hit puberty. You guys do okay. Get them some kind of treehouse to live in.
Take a long nap.
And guards. Prison guards.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Brandon.
Yeah.
You're 20. What's up?
I needed to know when the most fertile time for a female is. Because we had...
Well, you can't predict that.
Well...
It's about 15 days.
For me, October.
For me, judging from experience, it's from age usually 11 to 14. That's when they're at their peak.
Why do you want to know? Are you trying to have a kid?
No. Me and my fiance had sex the other night, and the condom broke.
Why didn't you immediately go out and get the morning after pill?
I asked her about it, and she said that she wasn't comfortable with something like that.
Why?
Because she wants to have kids.
Well, she's already has one.
That's what that means. I mean, why would she not take advantage of something to prevent the pregnancy?
I don't know. I heard you stress that to a number of callers.
What is there to be comfortable about?
Because some people still think it's abortion, probably.
It's not an abortion pill, Brandon. It just prevents her egg from ever being released.
Okay.
That's it. That's how it works.
Brandon?
Yeah.
How old is your fiance?
She's 19.
Mm. Can't you just put this in her food or something? I mean, seriously. This series is serious. Sprinkle it over her beef.
beef motto.
Hey, Brandon, how old is her kid?
2.
Oof.
Oh, boy. Yeah.
Pregnant at 15.
You want to get married, huh?
Well, yeah. We've been best friends for 9 years.
I see.
Mm. Mm. You've been caring for her for 9 years.
You can't.
You sure you're not gay?
I'm positive.
Why do you say that?
Well, best friends. I don't like when guys use that term with their girlfriend or wife.
No, that
means best friends.
They were best friends, and now but now you hate each other that you're together, right?
No, we're completely in love.
He's still best friends. Gay.
This is him taking care of an abused kid, probably, you know, helping protect her.
He's 20. And
then finally she caved in.
How old is she?
Years of him hovering around.
She's 19.
Hey, Brandon.
Right? Am I right on this one, Adam?
It does kind of. Yeah. Does she come from a little chaos?
A little bit, yeah.
Who's better looking, you or her? On you know,
yeah. Her.
Yeah, she's a lot better than you could normally get. You figure?
No.
But you've been hovering around for quite some time, right?
Actually, not really. We had a spell that we didn't talk for like 2 years.
Yeah. Otherwise, it's been 9 years of hovering.
You've liked her for a long time.
As on a friendship level.
Oh, Brandon.
No, you've been into her.
Come on.
At first, I mean, we dated before then.
Yeah.
Because you were not into her?
What?
Because you were not into her? Is that why you dated her?
No, I was into her.
That's the point.
Why did you? When she broke it off, right?
No, I broke it off with her.
Why did you do that?
I couldn't honestly tell you anymore. I don't remember.
How old were you?
I was 15.
That's when she got pregnant.
No, she got pregnant the next week.
No, she got pregnant with a guy after me.
All right. So anyway, Brandon, when was her period?
It ended a week ago.
All right.
Well, listen.
Not great timing.
Yeah, everyone loves mashed potatoes, right? Does she like mashed potatoes? Get one. You'll hold one of the morning after pills and just put it in there.
Get it. Call a doctor. 1-800-1888. Not too late.
Hey, let me grab a pen real quick.
All right.
Hey, Brandon.
Yeah.
You say this is how many days ago?
This was about 3 days ago.
Well, forget it. And get it for the next time.
Call 1-800 too late.
1-888 not too late.
888 not too late.
Not number two late. Not too late.
Too late. Okay.
Great. All right, Brandon. Thanks. Take care.
All right.
So Drew, then you're with me on the sprinkling it in her food?
You didn't hear me say no.
It's not a bad plan.
But I did notice you talking about the best friend thing. Jimmy and Gina seem to be just best friends.
Oh yes, we're best friends.
I noticed that.
They're soulmates. Yeah, they're soulmates.
I think he got up and announced something like the effect of, Gina, a lot of people don't like you.
Where? I gotta keep her, you know.
At the party?
Yeah, at the party here.
Oh really? Were you drunk?
I wasn't drunk, no.
Did she make you pay?
She was drunk. You have to keep her, you know how it is. You have to keep her in check when she's drunk. She starts telling embarrassing stories.
She was great.
Oh, yeah.
She was awesome.
I love hearing the story about when Jimmy cried when his dog Fluffy died.
Yeah. She thinks that's funny.
But what, Drew, your wife does the same thing. There's something about women, they have a few highballs and they love to just embarrass the hell out of the guy.
Yes.
What is that? Why? What are they paying you
back
for?
It's them taking back a little power.
Yeah.
Because you're the man and you get to be in charge all the time.
Haven't you done enough? You know what I mean? What is that? That's scary.
Just general abuse.
But no, what I mean is you get drunk. You don't have any other feelings other than sexual, let's say.
Right.
But you don't have it's payback time.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's a little disconcerting to be with someone who gets drunk and thinks it's payback time.
No, I don't get payback. What I get is sort of more stories that seem funny when you've been drinking and are just plain old embarrassing.
Yeah.
But Susan does, she will humiliate the hell out of you
but
with
not
a few
intentionally.
Boozes in her.
Not intentionally.
Well,
I don't think it's payback.
Everything's intentional, I believe. Just somewhere in
there. No
somewhere,
accidents.
No.
There are no accidents.
No.
And we'll be back after this.
Attention, there's valuable information coming up, and LoveLine will be right back on the New Rock Alternative, 94.7 NRK.
Love Line, create your love. Loveline moment at 800-191.
With your host, Adam Cole and Dr. Drew. 94.7 KNRK.
Line. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Bobo and Be Real are both here from Cypress Hill. Sarah?
Yeah?
You're 19.
Yes.
What's up?
I'm 19, and I have a thing for like 35, 36-year-old guys. I really like them.
Yeah.
That's good for you. Yeah,
it's perfect.
But I need to know if this is like a bad thing.
Not good for you.
Not
for
good.
You. Yeah, you're gonna. It sort of takes you away from your peers. It makes you focused on people that are really in a very different place in their life, and who might be looking at you more as an object and less as a person. Adam would be just awful to be around.
Yeah, it'd be horrible to be around me.
Yeah.
Adam,
yeah.
With an Adam,
and what about me? I have to be around me all the time.
You with a 19-year-old. Just think of that. Awful. Oh.
Yeah, her telling me to grow up.
Oh, that would hurt. Oh, yeah. Okay. That would hurt.
Hey, Sarah, you know, there's a sort of catch-22, which is 36-year-old guys that want to spend a lot of time with 19-year-old chicks are a little bit flawed, unless the chicks are really hot-looking. But even then, it's a little bit flawed. You know what I mean? So
it's by definition flawed.
So the catch-22 is every guy who's willing to hang out with you is kind of an idiot.
Yeah.
Oh, thanks.
No. Not because...
I understand.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying.
But, okay, now, is there any way to stop myself from liking these guys? Because I've tried to like guys my age, and
Well, look at the source. Did your dad go away when you were young or something?
I grew up without a dad.
Yeah. So did he leave when you were like two?
No, actually, my mom never told her boyfriend that she was pregnant.
How long was he around at all?
No, I don't even know who he is.
He never knew.
Yeah, but I thought maybe he came back.
Was there another guy in the picture?
There was one, and there was another one when I, yeah. There were a couple.
Did you like those guys?
Huh?
Did you like some of those guys?
The one she has now is pretty good.
No, when you were younger, were you connected to one of them?
Oh, no, not at all.
No.
Yeah.
So you're looking to replace someone.
Everyone's
looking
daddy.
For the father figure.
Yeah.
Right.
So is there any way to train myself not to like him? I mean, knowing that, I mean, that's something that I've always kind of figured was the problem, but it doesn't help.
Doesn't help it go away.
How about you find like a nice 25-year-old guy who spent too much time in the sun or something? You know what I mean?
You know, what's interesting, I wonder if she were with the older guy, would it be a stable guy? If she were to choose a 25-year-old, it would be the guy that was ready to leave.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Well, whether she would act that out.
I was with a 36-year-old guy, but he was married.
Oh, boy.
My problem now is that there's another guy. I didn't know anything about him. We started talking, and I liked him, and, you know, he's, you know, right around 36, and I just found out he's married.
Right.
Nothing's going on there, but how can I stop myself from liking him?
You can't.
Don't talk to a lesbian.
Yeah, listen, why don't you find a nice 24-year-old Jewish guy, because those guys act like they're 45.
Okay.
Start dating more regularly, and you'll find that people become less of these objects and more somebody you really start caring about.
Okay.
You know what I mean? They're less of the symbols.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
All right.
Bye.
All right, yeah.
Stay away from the married dudes.
Are you going to be able to talk her out of that, though?
No.
You know what I mean?
Not completely, no.
Like, I like the big jugs, you know?
Yeah. Well, you may be able to talk her out of this one, but not the next one.
Yeah.
Right. You know what magazine I picked up the other day?
Let me guess. Busty?
Well, you're close. This is the Big Boob Cruise.
Jugs?
What is it?
Every year. Now, I didn't go in to pick this magazine up. I was trying to get a car magazine,
right.
But you know what happened. There's the Big Boob Cruise just burning a hole
what
in you while the guy goes back to get the back issue of Car and Driver, and you're just staring at that Big Boob Cruise.
Right.
This magazine, it's I think it's Score magazine.
Oh.
And each year, they have this Big Boob Cruise. Minka was on it. She's the number one Asian Big Boob Queen.
Wow.
And they go out on a boat with like 15 of the biggest of the big top porn chicks. And like 8 guys with 7 million rolls of film and 700 cases of beer, and it must cost these guys like $20,000 or something.
Oh, just seven.
And they go on this like Jamaican cruise on this yacht, and it's like here's what it is. It's like somebody took a strip club and put pontoons on it and just floated you out in the ocean with you and your buddies for a week.
Adam, you have reason to live now.
I know.
Reason to work.
I know.
It's a goal.
That's what I was thinking. Yeah. I got to get onto this big boob cruise. Imagine being on the big boob cruise.
Yeah, he might not want to come back.
He may never come back.
Just think of how the reuniting experience would be with Minka.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
God.
Oh, it's been so long since she's kneed me in the groin. Drew, I'm going to bring this thing in on Sunday night. You're going nuts when you see this big boob cruise. They got pictures of them like on the plane flying over to Jamaica, then on out on the cruise, and then they're like on the beach playing volleyball, and they're doing like lap dances on the top side while the chef's down below whipping up some confection. I mean, this is the greatest. This is like and it's funny because these guys are all in their 40s. It's a weird thing because you couldn't afford the big boob cruise unless you had a few serious bucks in the bank. So it just means it's for older guys. I don't know if any of them are married. I can imagine your wife grabs an issue of the Big Boob Cruise magazine, and there you are.
Awful.
You crawled under Minka, and there's a picture of you. Drew, I'm going to bring this thing, and you'll go nuts.
He may want to go on vacation.
Yeah, he might take the Big Boob Cruise. Dimitri?
Yeah.
What's up? You're 15.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
All right. You're a god, Adam.
Thank you.
Yeah. You converted me to atheism.
Oh, thank you.
That's
thank
nice.
You. I, you know, I'd like to get more kids into Satan worship and Santeria, but that's great.
And Drew, your side's great.
Thank you. What's up, Major?
All right, I can't get my girlfriend to kiss me.
How come?
I don't know.
Have you asked her?
No.
Have you tried to kiss her?
No.
Maybe he has halitosis.
Yeah, is your breath humming?
He hasn't tried to kiss her.
Oh.
Oh.
What will she do? Will she do other things?
You expect her to try to kiss you first?
I don't know.
Well, hold on a second.
Wait a minute.
Do you do anything with her?
I've only been going out with her for about 2 weeks.
I know. So it's not like you get sex, but she won't kiss you.
Yeah.
It's not like that.
No.
Yes, it's not like
yes,
that.
Yes, it's not.
Yeah. Okay. So you don't do anything.
No.
How do you know you're going out with her?
Asked her out.
Okay, but you know, I've learned from this show, and I wish it was something I learned in high school, that sometimes when you ask the woman, they'll tell you a different story. You mowing her lawn is not you two dating. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But he has not tried to kiss her. How do you end your dates?
Take her up to her door, basically.
And then
what about a little peck on the lips there?
Nothing.
But
you don't, I know. Why don't you drop your hanky, a fairy?
Yeah, it's
you
not,
kiss her, you idiot.
How old is she?
She's 16.
Wait, why don't you kiss her right then?
Maybe I should.
Oh boy,
does she? Does she wait for you? Does she pause for a second? Or
no, she doesn't. She just goes in the door.
She runs in.
Oh,
okay. Listen, I want to say this, Drew. We've talked about this before. How much time have you spent in your life, especially your younger life, high school, college, maybe, thinking about making a move?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
At junior high, spending so much time thinking about making that move and how uncomfortable, how it becomes bigger than it actually is. But here's the reality. How many times you guys actually ever been turned down when you try to kiss a girl? Do you know what I'm saying? Outside of the family, let's say. You know what I mean? I mean, I'm a very desirable guy, and I haven't been turned down that much. I mean, I've probably been turned down 3 times out of the 50 times I've tried it.
Right.
Here's my point. They won't turn you down nearly as much as you think they will, especially if you're standing on their porch after a night at the theater.
Or
you know?
if things are really so difficult to sort of overcome some barrier, it's because they're putting that up there.
Yeah.
And that means you shouldn't be putting all the emphasis on this one.
So you haven't tried.
No, wait, where is he? Oh, screw
so
him.
So he hasn't tried. He said he hasn't tried?
He's waiting for her to do something.
Yeah, well, what is this?
He's a little shy.
You got to initiate.
Yeah.
And you know, don't be scared.
Yeah, women want that.
You got to go for broke.
Oh, my God. When I was 16, I went on a date with Flory Aguilar. Okay?
Hello, Flory.
Now, first off, we went into Westwood. And for those of you who don't live around here, that was the place you went on a date.
For movies.
When you lived around here, you go in there and see a movie.
Go to yesterday's restaurant.
We went to Westwood to see a movie. I borrowed my stepmother's Honda. And that was back, you know, she had like a 77 Honda. So it was about as big as one of those Shriners cars they drive in the parade.
Yeah.
Your head hangs out of the sunroof, you know. We went down to Westwood One, me and Flory.
Westwood.
I mean, sorry, now I'm at Westwood One. Went down to Westwood, saw, for some reason, and maybe it's because everything else was sold out or something, saw the David Bowie movie, The Man Who Fell from Earth, which is a bizarre movie at any age.
Yeah, but you're high school, that's...
It was bizarre. There's a part where like a guy's talking to a girl's talking into a guy's penis like a microphone. It's a bizarre movie to go on a first date.
That's step up to the mic.
Yeah, it's very uncomfortable.
Step up to the mic.
Very uncomfortable. So I drove her home after what was probably a horrible date for her. And I went to kiss her in the car. And because my arms stretch out like a condor and I'm driving this Honda that's about 2.5 feet wide, I actually elbow her right in the chops as I try to reach the right arm around.
That set the mood, didn't it?
Yeah, good. I mean, if we're playing hockey, I would have been thrown in the penalty box for that move. So I whack her in the face with my elbow, and there was no second date. But...
That's pretty surprising.
Years of good stories.
That is not going to happen to anyone else who's listening. You kiss her, you're the guy. All right, Bobo and Be Real are both here from Cypress Hill. We'll take a little break after this.
Whoa.
Loveline. 1-800-LOVE-191. We'll be right back.
Hey now, don't get your panties in a bunch. Loveline will be right back on 94.7 NRK, the new rock alternative.
Nope. Yep, it is Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Kim Coles is our guest tonight. All the, what is it, five seasons Living Single?
Five seasons of Living Single. Thank you very much. Wow. And it's on, like, you know, twice a day.
Oh, yeah.
Syndication.
That's
which
right.
Which is lovely to me.
Oh.
It's lovely. Those checks come in.
Let me explain how syndication works. I won't get into the details and the numbers. Here's what you do. You walk to the mailbox, you open the mailbox, and then you laugh like a hyena as you walk back
to your
house.
About every 3 months.
Yeah. Every 3 months. In your slippers and rope with your big nails.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And then airbrushness. You like color? What color? You pick color.
And then you bitch about giving the poor Korean woman, mother of eight, $2.
I usually give them three. You know,
what other job do you get? Just go to the mailbox. Imagine that, everyone. Imagine you got a job where you do your job.
Then you finish the job.
You get paid very well for doing that job that day. And then a few years down the road, you just go to the mailbox and, whoa, there's a big chunk.
There's a little something in there for you.
Hey, remember when you cleaned the carpet over at the Sizzler in 94? Yeah. Here's $5,000. Wow.
It's a racket.
Yeah, it's great. Thank God they're on strike. They got to get more money. A lot of those actors only, you know, they only make $5,000 a day. Those commercial actors. We got a band together, everyone. Janelle?
I'd like to make a case for the waitresses out there.
You're 21, yeah.
Yeah, and I'm from the San Francisco Bay Area, and I do work at a very nice restaurant.
Yeah.
And I don't make over $25,000 a year.
Hey, you know that restaurant Farallon?
No.
But they actually bought me dinner there the other night. It was a great meal, and they came out and bought dinner.
Who cares? Hey, Janelle?
Yeah.
You work an expensive restaurant?
Yeah, it's not as expensive as the one you were talking about, but it's a nice restaurant.
Well, what do people traditionally drop when they go there?
Usually about 20%.
But how much money are they usually dropping? Let's say...
Oh, per ticket?
Let's say a couple or four people, two couples go out for dinner. What does it cost then usually?
Anywhere over $100.
For two couples?
For one couple. For
one couple. It's over $100.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay, so let me ask you a quick question. Sure. I won't dwell on this, but how many tables as a waitress at a nice place like that do you work at once, simultaneously?
For me, because I have so much overhead, like I have someone who runs my food. I have a busser that takes care of coffees and stuff like that. I also have a hostess who sits me and a bartender who does my drinks separately.
What does that mean? You pay those people?
How many? Yeah, you got to take them out.
Yeah, I pay four people.
How many? Okay, but answer me. How many tables do you work simultaneously?
Right. Because I have that much help, I'm able to handle anywhere from 8 to about 13 tables at once.
At once?
Yes.
So
not an easy job.
I know. Okay. Mm-hmm. Listen, genius. So you got 8 tables going at once.
Oh, yeah.
All of them are averaging about $100, let's say, if it's a couple. And so you're getting $20 per table.
Times 10, let's say.
Times 10. And they're in there for an hour, hour and a half, something like that.
Really more like times 15 because it's a lot of couples and things.
Yeah, they don't always tip 10, 20%.
Right. But
this is my point.
But the point is what do you make in an hour? On a shift, how many hours shift are you working?
Like 5 to 6 hours.
And what are you walking out of there with?
About $100.
On a 5-6 hour shift?
Yes, because I have to tip out about 10%
right.
of my sales.
All right,
sales.
But how much of that do you have to report?
I report anything that goes onto a credit card because we use a computer system that automatically logs
okay,
it.
But you're still making $20 an hour.
Right, but then
okay.
I get my biweekly check and it's about $20.
Okay, but here's my point. All the years I worked as a carpenter, read plans, built houses, dealt with building inspectors, had my tools and trucks and everything, I made $15 an hour. So stop it. You waiters and waitresses act like you have a skill. You have no skill. You slop the hogs for a living.
That is
you
so highfalutin mean. People. I've defended you on so many things.
No, Janelle, now you see him for what he really is.
I don't.
Oh my
start
God,
defending
I'm
me
so
against
offended.
Him. Come on, Janelle. Let's line up against him.
You know, you do. Here's the way waiters and waitresses should work. Your boss should pay you $8 or $9 an hour, and that should be it.
That's how they do it in Europe.
That's fine.
And the tip is included.
That's
but unfortunately,
fine.
We leave it up to humans to go ahead and tip what they think we deserve.
Right.
And very honestly, if everyone tipped me 10%, I'd walk away with $0 out the door because I have to tip out 10%.
All right. All
for the record, myself. I'm an excellent tipper.
I am too. I just complain a lot.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
You know, they work hard, Adam. Come on. They're on their feet.
What do carpet layers do?
I'm not saying they're not hard on your feet, too, but you know, it's
a little bit of a sales marketing job,
a service
job they're doing,
yes.
You know?
Listen to me.
So, would you like gravy with that, Miss Coles? I mean, you know, I tip a little extra.
Would you like some white gravy with your brown gravy, Miss Coles? Yes, thank you. Just a dollar.
Thank you. Here's an extra dollar.
Here's a dollar. Oh, wait a minute. My nails are dry. Could you blow on those? Please, blow on them. That's my tipping hand. Come blow on my tipping hand. Thank you. Now, get away. Get away. They're dry. Get away. Scurry.
Blow on my tipping hand.
it's warming. It's getting warm. It's getting warm. You better blow on it. Cool it off. Yes, thank you.
Rob? 19.
Hi, how's it going?
Hey, Rob.
What's up?
I had a couple questions regarding HPV.
Yep.
And one of them was, is there a way for them to test for it in males?
Is that warts, Drew?
You always
chime in with what it is.
It's warts. You really have to see them. And as Adam will tell you, there's a special way to test for the pre-wart lesions.
Is it
that's
with
right.
the acetic acid?
Yeah, yeah.
Does it get like really white when you do it?
Yeah, you can see them. You have to shine a black light on it after you put the acetic acid over it.
Oh, okay. And then the other question mm-hmm. was regarding THGW. It's supposed to be like a vaccine for it. A company in the UK makes it.
Well, there are multiple vaccines being developed, but nothing's available yet here.
Is it close to like becoming available or what?
It's a week to 10 days.
Yeah, it's close.
Yeah, when Jesus comes back, like you said.
Go up to the mountaintop of the folding chair. He'll be here.
It probably by the time you're through your prime, it's you're going to have to make it through your prime without a vaccine.
You'll be married and have 3 kids by the time they come with the vaccine. Yeah. Aren't they starting to think that warts, now they used to think warts never went away.
Right.
And now they're starting to think they burn out.
That certain subtypes burn out, yeah.
Nice. Drew, check my dork with
acetic acid.
And a black light.
What's acetic acid? I'm thinking acetic
vinegar.
Acid, you squeeze a Jew when he gets
like
acid.
It's like vinegar.
Never
like
ends vinegar. With the blacks and the Jews. Never ends. So, yeah, you put this acid, it's like vinegar on your penis, mm-hmm. and then you shine this black light on it, and it, you know, winks at you if you have a wart,
right,
basically.
Right.
Who did that to my Johnson?
Plenty of it. He was clean. He was a stunt penis. He put he smoked mirrors on how he did it, but he put a different penis.
My penis is still in the cellophane it came in.
Suspicious.
Laura. Laura, you're 20.
Hey, Adam.
Hey, what's up?
I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
I got the tail end of a call yesterday, and I think it was like a 31-year-old male who had arthritis, and I think you called it cirrhosis, but...
No, psoriatic arthritis.
Okay, that makes more sense. And you said it was an autoimmune disease.
Right.
And every once in a while, for a couple of months, when I get really stressed out, I'll get pain in my hands and my feet.
Yeah, but that's stress.
Right. Is there...
That's fibromyalgia, closer to that than anything else.
Okay. Is there anything I can do for that to ride it out until
sleep
I'm done?
Better.
Sleep, yeah.
You got to sleep better. That really? To me is a sleep deprivation syndrome.
Okay. That is?
Yep.
Okay. Yeah. And I have to say, Kim, I enjoyed the show last week.
Thank you.
It was great. And you should be a regular on the show. You're hilarious.
Well, I actually am a regular okay. on the show. You will see me every week.
Right on.
She's
right
bringing
on.
Adam and me
no,
on.
No, I mean on LoveLine.
Oh, you're delightful.
Yes.
I wouldn't mind another check.
Yeah.
Let's talk.
This ain't going to be the kind of check you're used to.
You're so sweet. Thank you.
No problem. And Adam, I love you.
Thank you, baby.
And actually, I have a little proposition for you.
Uh-oh.
I know how you hate to pay taxes.
Yes.
And I've heard you say once or twice you wish you could have a couple of kids just to funnel that money into.
I wish you could be one of your dependents.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, no. I have said that I would like to just start adopting and sponsoring individual callers' kids.
Hey.
And here's the way I'd like my taxes to be taken care of.
Uh-huh.
I want to see where it's going. I want a stretch of highway, mm-hmm. a couple of orphan kids, and like, part of a daycare center or something in the inner city that I actually has a plaque with my name in front of it.
Annual report.
Well, here's what I'm
thinking.
Like
three grenades and half a tent or something for the army. I want all my little pieces. Yeah, go ahead, Laura.
Well, you can pay for my college.
Okay.
Tax deductible.
Fine. It'll be a check in the mail starting tomorrow. Where are you going?
Well, oh, God. Well, I'm thinking for grad school. I just transferred to in Washington State, but I was at USC.
You were? Yeah. That's no school. Drew
went
there.
Were you there for grad school, Drew?
For medical school, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
It's not a real college, though.
Well, it was a little disturbing anyway.
Yeah.
But it got a little expensive.
I understand.
So I had to come home.
All right. Well, you're fine. What do you want to be when you grow up?
I have no idea.
Well, go with veterinarian. Seems like the ladies are into that. There's not a woman. I've never met a woman who didn't want to be a veterinarian at some point in her life.
Hate animals.
Yeah.
Have a goldfish that died, and I think the housekeeper like threw him out or something. Like I put the bowl by the sink to be washed, and the next thing I knew it was gone, and I forgot about it for like 3 weeks. I didn't even know it was missing. I could care less about dogs, cats. I've now offended.
Yeah,
see, Pakistanis.
Jews.
Koreans, Jews, and
Vietnamese.
Vietnamese and right. pet lovers. Thank you.
Yeah, what?
Animal rights activists.
Yeah, I'm with you. I'm with you on that. Okay, so you didn't want to be veterinary. Every other woman I've ever spoken to wanted to be one. Chad?
Yeah?
You're 16. What's up? Hold on. What did you want to be?
What did I want to be?
No, Chad,
I wanted
hold on.
To be an anthropologist.
Oh, really?
I did. Like a cultural anthropologist. I would have made no money, but it would have been really interesting.
Thank Hold on a second, Chad.
Or makeup artist.
You know what's funny? Okay, good. More realistic. You know what's funny is we talked a lot of models and actresses and stuff, and for some reason, it's very important when you make a living as a model, especially, but sometimes as an actress, mainly as a model, that you put something very heady down on your bio about wanting to be that
I
at one time.
I swear.
No, it seemed to me most of them went to medical school.
Well,
No.
They were pre-med.
No.
Pre-med.
They were in medical school and left.
Oh, really?
They wanted to be something very heady and lofty and settled on modeling. And here's the deal. I don't give a rat's ass what you wanted to be. I thought I was going to be the first president astronaut when I was five.
You were eight,
I turned out clean carpets. All right. But the point is what I thought I was going to be just makes me an idiot. It makes me grandiose. You know what I mean? So like, she wanted to be a veterinarian. She wanted to be a physicist, astronaut, veterinarian.
I wanted to be the first black woman in space. I used to watch, what's that show? The
Lost
family.
In space.
Lost in space. Space. And I was like, mommy, daddy, can we be the first black family in space?
Danger,
and so I thought.
Danger
Will Robinson. That? Thank you. And I thought, you know, if Uhura can do it. Uhuru,
or yeah, the black chick the, on Star Trek.
I thought
right.
I could do it too. And then, you know, I turned 9. But hold on, or whatever.
That's
you know.
Like a million years in the future.
Pretty much. I'm just glad to see black people in space. A spaceship, yeah. You know, 3,000 years from now. That was promising for us.
Yeah, the Lost
we held on to that. We really did. Lost, and we've regressed since.
Lost in Space was great because they left that pedophile guy, Dr. Smith. openly gay pedophile. They always leave him in charge of the kid, you know?
All the time. Young Will. Happy Will. I don't know. We got off on a tangent. Sorry.
It's like, what part do you play on TV? The gay cowardly guy? Who's stuck on a planet? Oh, fantastic. You must have a great agent. All right, Christy, were we going to talk to Christy?
Yeah,
Michael
Christy.
Hughes, you're 18. What's up?
I need to know why I'm cheating on my boyfriend. And I care for him, and he cares for me, and we're in love, supposedly, okay? And he's very good to me. He's the best thing that's ever happened to me.
Well, you don't like that. You like the dangerous pain in the ass guys.
Yeah.
That's what you think of as caring, loving. That's who you are in a relationship, is somebody who's connected with somebody who is not actually available to you. Right?
That's disheartening.
Isn't that true?
I like masculine men, if that's what you mean.
Yeah. Where's your daddy?
He's at home.
Is he good? Any you lose anybody? Anything get taken away from you?
No, but I'm not close to my parents.
Why not?
Why not?
My mom doesn't care anymore.
Why not?
That's not an answer. Your mom doesn't care anymore?
What does that mean, yeah?
Well, she's tired of having kids, and she's, I don't know.
You get the feeling she was tired of you guys earlier than this?
Yeah. Is she alcoholic?
No.
How many siblings do you have?
Just four.
Just four.
Four and you?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's pretty healthy.
Yeah.
It's tough when you're tired of kids. You got a whole brood of them.
And what's your dad's deal?
He's a devout Catholic.
Yeah. And, is he kind of an angry, aggressive guy?
No, he's really passive.
He is. And
it's hard for me to connect with him.
Did he have time for you?
No, not as a child.
Hmm. Yeah.
He was working a lot.
How old's your boyfriend right now?
27.
Oh, jeez.
27? You're 18, and you're having sex with other guys?
Not anymore.
How many guys would you say you screwed around with?
I used to. About two other guys.
About?
Yeah.
Okay, so about five guys.
Yeah, but I went out on dates and stuff. And
hey, where's your boyfriend? Where's he living?
In Louisiana.
Uh-huh.
And where are you?
In Texas.
I see. And why are you hooked up with a guy who's 27 and living
1,000 miles away?
Yeah. What's up with
because
that?
Because we're like good friends, too. I mean,
you treat him like a good friend.
Oh, yeah.
You treat him like a great friend, Chrissy.
Yeah, you're wonderful.
Well, we can talk about anything. I don't
know. Well, anything except for the guys you're banging. We'll write that down, Drew. That was good. That was like out of an Aaron Spelling. Anything? I don't think so, Christy. What about Dr. Rex Dexler you're having sex with? whose child you're carrying? Okay, so listen. The guy's out of state. He's 10 years older than you. You're 18, you're amorous, you're looking for daddy. Why don't you just forget it? Just break up with the guy. Give him a break.
I don't want to.
Well, then commit yourself to this thing if that's what you want to have.
How about doing that then?
Do I need help or something?
Well, it's hard to say. You're at an age when sort of experimentation, trying to figure out who you are in a relationship is normal.
You're a good-looking 18-year-old girl, right?
Yeah.
Right?
I'd like to think so.
listen. Okay, here's what I'm thinking. As a guy, when you want to commit yourself to a relationship, let's say you're equivalent to Christy, you're a guy, and you're saying, I got a girl, I love her very much, I've been unfaithful, I'd like to not do that anymore. Here's all you have to
do.
No
problem.
Stop doing it.
Well, stop.
Stop you, sending drinks over, yeah. Stop cruising, stop doing it, stop working. Now, as an attractive 18-year-old girl, It's like being in a rock band, being out on tour, and trying not to do any more coke.
Yeah.
What I mean is you're right in the thick of things. Yeah. It ain't going to work, Drew. That's not going to work, right?
It's going to be a problem for you her. She wants to sabotage straight away anyway.
Right. And meanwhile, this guy's 27. He has a long-distance relationship with an 18-year-old. I don't trust him. And no. God knows what he's up to in Louisiana. Yeah, exactly. So.
He's getting some Baton Rouge. Okay. That was good. I'm sorry.
Oh, she's having her period. Don't worry about it. You're PMS. You're PMS. They call it PMDD now. Premenstrual dysphoric disorder.
Oh, dysphoric?
Yes.
Oh, okay. What is
mood,
that?
Mood problems. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah, you have to change the name. No medical nomenclature. You got to change names every 5 years.
Yeah. Like black people change it. We're colored. We're Negro. We're black. Right. African-American. I'm confused.
Right. And here's the point. The reason, I'm not sure about the blacks, but I do know about in medical.
The Negroes.
The reason in medicine they change it is because once everyone starts catching on with the lingo, then it's like, hey, anyone could do this job. Right, right. So we got to step up again.
No, it's even more than that. It's the new guys coming in who need to sort of set themselves apart from the old guard.
Mm. Right. Okay.
That's really what it is.
Give us some of the ways you've heard basic words pronounced. It always drives me insane.
Oh, nomenclature becomes nomenclature.
Right.
Skeleton.
Really? And they're changing the names?
Umbilicus. Umbilicus.
No.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah. They
cool.
They spread it around.
Umbilicus.
Yeah. To me, it's Demi Moore and Demi Moore.
I know.
It's for a million years, it was always the Cannes Film Festival. It's now the Cannes Film Festival. Mm-hmm. And I think there's a couple other ones out there in Hollywood that drive me insane.
You say tomato, I say tomato. I mean,
but I really miss the new guys have to carve out their stake their claim.
Are they really changing the name of
PMDD?
Oh God! All right. Whatever it's called, it's hell. Pretty much.
Chad,
yeah,
you're 16.
Oh, I just want to say, Adam, you rock, man.
Thank you.
I love the man show.
Whatever.
Oh, great! Thank you. What's up?
Me and my girlfriend, we were about to have sex a few days ago, and we tried for about 20 minutes, and I couldn't fit in her.
This was your first fry?
Yeah, both of ours.
Right. Well, she got to uncross her legs.
Is there an anatomic difference between the two of you, or is it that she was so uptight that she was tight?
I'm not really sure.
I'd play the anatomic angle myself.
I'd play the nervous angle myself. Mm.
Well, no, if I was Chad.
Oh, so you'd say it was
play that card. Yeah.
I see.
Sure. So when Chad, are you exceptionally wide?
Not really.
No.
Average.
When women are very anxious, nervous, they clamp down.
Okay.
And you don't get in. And that's her body telling you she's not ready to have you in.
Is there any way we could fix that?
Yeah, wait a little bit, talk to her.
Run and start some parquet.
Yeah, I know that he wants a. This is what men become their most sort of concrete, most deliberate, and.
Well, it's the only time they really care about the vagina. Oh, I see. How can we rectify this for us?
Yeah, but they horrible. Never. But it's like they're talking about
the vagina. Sorry, they changed the name. The of vagina.
It's like they're talking about hanging a door, though. There's no person attached to it.
Right.
Just
right.
Let's fix this thing.
And can we just open this up? Yeah. Healthy pink vagina. Oh, that's for me. Oh my God. You found that. That's great. That's me.
Yeah, you can put your shirt back down now.
My healthy
Are you hot, Daddy?
No, that's
not
that,
me.
That's
Jennifer Lewis or something.
No, it was...
Who is that? Oh,
what's her name?
Are you hot, Daddy?
I know. I can see her face.
Are you hot, Daddy?
That
from
is...
Moesha.
But I'm real fat.
That's,
oh, that's
no,
Monique.
That,
Monique.
That's Monique, yeah. Monique.
Have you got all the black girls on one tape?
Yeah, it's a...
I said hot pink vagina. What is it? Healthy pink vagina. Are you hot, Daddy? And I'm not fat. That's hysterical.
Hey, Chad.
Yeah.
How old is she?
16.
And
she's not ready.
Is she a virgin?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So she's a little uptight. So listen, just take it slow.
Take your time.
Right. Take it and get some wine coolers. And just
it's 16. That's
okay.
Nice.
Well, here's my point.
Maybe just, a little acid, mix it up.
That's right. Ether rag and some duct tape, some Quaaludes
no,
and some roofies. No, just, Chad, you got to just take it real slow. She got to be relaxed.
All right.
You understand?
All right.
It's really good to her.
Chad.
My cat analogy.
Is this his first time is what I want to know.
Nah, we don't care about him.
Okay.
All right. Let's talk
He's fine.
To
He's fine.
Brian.
We got to go to Brian.
Brian.
Yes.
You're calling from the ocean? Where are you? You in your car?
Yeah, I'm in my car.
I see. What do you want to know?
I've been dating my current girlfriend for about 8 months, and so far I haven't been able to get her to orgasm once. And I've talked with her about it, and I don't think she's ever even been able to make herself orgasm. So she's...
Temerity of that woman.
Yes, how dare she. And?
Let's take a break.
All right, wait a minute. Yeah?
So she's 22, and I think she's getting to an age old enough to where she should be able to orgasm. Sure.
Honey, you're old enough now.
Listen, you're 22, your vagina should know better.
Right.
It's not a little girl vagina anymore.
Healthy pink vagina.
Yeah, your clitoris is in college. Your labia is...
Labia.
Your labia. I mean, that was my... when I was doing mornings in Tucson on AM, Dusty,
your handle?
Dusty Labia.
That's
was what I... Dusty Labia! Mornings with Dusty Labia.
We'll hear more about it.
All right.
We'll get back to Brian, too.
We'll take a... Kim Coles is here. We'll take a little break.
Loveline will be right back, so get your problems ready.
Don't touch that dial. Loveline will be right back with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew right here on 94.7 NRK, the new rock alternative.
Show known as Loveline.
With your hosts, Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
94.7 NRK.
I want his
job. Padgett want to know if I wake up at 3 in the afternoon. And then what I do is I get down, I get nude, and I hit the yard.
Exactly. That's what I figured. You have the life.
John's wife, Sarah, is usually going out to collect the mail about that time.
That's what that big shriek is about 3 in the afternoon.
She secretly digs it, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah.
No, I'm sure she doesn't.
She is the coolest chick on earth.
Yeah, she really is. Yes. She really is great. We talk through the fence, and we always... make some plans about getting together, but it
and then it never happens.
No.
That's the great thing, because she keeps the link alive, and
right,
and makes sure that it's impossible to actually follow through on.
One of these days, I'm going to get drunk and get my pellet gun out and do some serious damage. Some serious damage to the Cryer household.
Just steer clear of the woodwork, okay? The mahogany is tough to replace.
That is beautiful. John lives in a beautiful home up there, Drew. Beautiful mahogany woodwork.
Neat.
Yeah, not like that 80s trash you live in. This is real. This ain't the Pergo family hut that you're in over there. This is real old-time craftsmanship. You understand that, Drew?
I understand.
Okay.
Dick.
John Cryer, Larry Joe Campbell, and Padgett Brewster are all here from The Trouble with Normal. That is Friday nights, 8:30 on ABC, part of the new lineup with the Finnegan men and the Norm and the Brennigan guy trio. What the hell?
Two guys and a girl.
Two guys, a girl, yeah. Which is, I like to call it the little show that could, because nobody put a lot of stock in that show 14 years ago when it hit the air.
PBS. Had you on it.
I was on that damn show. I guest starred on that show.
Really?
Yeah.
Hey.
Yeah.
So did I, actually, once.
Yeah, I was, I played myself. Anyway, I wasn't convincing, but I was all over the show. Remember that, Drew?
Ridiculous.
Thank you. All right. And Norm, which is a show I like, not because it's a great show. I just love Norm MacDonald. I really do. And not as a human being. He's a horrible alcoholic gambler. But, well, he'd admit that. But he's funny. I like the guy.
I like that Laurie Metcalf, I must say.
Yes, she's talented. All right, Drew, we ready to keep rolling here?
Just keep going one number after the next.
All right.
No special order, as you say.
All right, you don't have your screen up there in San Francisco?
No, it's driving me insane.
Sam?
Yep.
You're 18. What's up?
I masturbate once every 2 to 3 weeks.
Oh.
Congratulations.
How old are you?
18.
You can do it more.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't even think about it more. And the worst thing is, I'm not having sex or hand jobs, blow jobs, anything.
How old are you? How
18.
Old? 18.
You just may not have the most pronounced sex drive. That's, you know, I mean, I don't know, Dr. Drew, is there an area that you have to hit, you
no.
know, in
your
terms
belly,
of...
Your belly, I think.
I was just going to say, statistically, is there an area you have to hit in order to be a normal human?
No, I'm not sure that, I mean... I'm not. I don't. That number must be out there, but it's not something that's sort of usually discussed.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, wait a minute.
Well, this is the place to discuss it. If ever there was a place
for an 18-year-old once a day. Come on. Yeah, you're. I'm scared you have a tumor.
I think it's more like two or three times a week.
Two or three times a week at 18.
Median average. Yeah.
No way. No way.
I understand you and your friends were on some sort of holy tear.
Yes, you'd be thrown
year after year.
You would have been thrown right out of our club and we would have demanded our jacket back. You're no longer one of the jackers.
The jacker jacket?
That's right. That's right. Rip the stripes right off the lapel, slap you across the face with the gym sock, and it's right it's back to your house.
But is our caller still there?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm here.
You want any medication?
No, I'm not.
Do you have any medical problems?
No.
Do you, normal puberty? Puberty came out at normal time, that kind of thing?
Yeah.
Your normal height and weight?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Well, why don't you get with it a little more, see if you can...
It depends on the context, whether or not it's something medically relevant.
I mean, it might actually keep you from doing a lot of stupid crap. Because let me tell you, needing to do it often at that age made me do some stupid stuff.
And that jacker group that Adam hung around with, they became insane. They literally started doing crap.
That's right. We were crazy. We robbed a sperm bank once. We turned to crime. We had an insatiable appetite for sperm. it's no different than any drug.
Yeah, but
that's why they got to legalize it. That's how the mob took over.
Whatever excrement you could get out of your guys' body and throw at each other.
Bathtub jizz. Speakeasy.
The jacker menace.
All right. Drew, how dare you? John, you can't see into my house, can anybody?
No, because your house is perched high on a hill.
Yeah, once in
it
a while.
It's mine that you can see into.
I try to make it from the den up the stairs in the nude and wonder if John is anywhere to be found. All right. Where the hell? Chris.
Yes, sir.
You're 23.
Thanks.
What's up?
I have a friend who is being physically abused by her ex-boyfriend, and she won't press charges or do anything about it. So I want to know if there's anything I can do or anybody I can contact or anything that I can do to help her.
How is she still having contact with him if it's
her ex? He's trying to get her back, and she's not doing a very good job of ignoring him. So she lets her in his house. She takes rides home from school from him, stuff like that. So when he gets her alone, he knocks her down. He grabs her, puts bruises on her arms, stuff like that. So she's got bruises on her arms and neck and like rib cage and stuff.
And you're just her friend? Do you like her?
I dated her for a couple of weeks, but it was too psychotic, so I got out. And
she's chaotic.
Yeah, she's
got her dad was abusive.
I don't know, but this guy has pushed her down in front of the dad, and the dad doesn't do anything.
That's nice. Also, the girl must be dealing with something like that because she wouldn't put up with it if it hadn't been reinforced somehow.
Where do you live?
What's that?
Where do you live?
Sacramento.
I would suggest you call the police and ask for their help because domestic violence in California is a huge issue. And actually, if you know something like this going on, you have an obligation to report it.
Well, I know, and that's
call social services, but I would call police.
All right, okay. But hold on a second. Here's my feeling about everyone calling the police for everything. That means less police for me, who needs the police every once in a while and who pays more taxes than all you slackers. So stop calling the cops for everyone all the time. Drives me nuts. Cats in the tree, call the cops. The refrigerator, it looks like it's leaking. There's some kind of fluid coming out. Get 911. Let's get the cops up here. All this domestic stuff, get out of harm's way. You tell her, Chris, to get away from this guy.
She doesn't buy it. She won't.
Can you get her steered toward therapy? Because, this is going to continue.
Yeah, I know.
Survivor group.
If her alone, it's going to be somebody else eventually.
Of course. So as a friend, why don't you try to steer towards some therapy or something like
that? Okay, Drew, I have another quick question for you.
Yeah.
Is there any hotline or anything I can call to get a referral for a like relationship addiction support group sort of thing?
What do you got going? That for her?
What is he looking for?
I'm looking for like a support group for people who can't deal with themselves when they're not in a relationship.
Is that her still?
No, that's me.
Oh,
wow. Did you have an addict parent?
Father was an alcoholic, but sober when I was probably one, and has been perfect ever since.
I would just say you just start with Al-Anon, because that really helps heal that part that causes that sort of intense need for a relationship to fix you.
Hey, Chris, we're opening a Sacramento chapter of the Jackers.
Yes, right.
I don't know if you're cut out of the right.
Do I get a jacket, he said.
You earn the jacket.
If I can get a jacket, I'm in.
It's sort of like those gang initiations when all the guys sort of pounce on the other guy, but it's got a little twist at the end. I can't mention the bylaws, so don't permit me from mentioning it over the air, but it's
what is the caller's name?
Call the twist, you know?
What's your name, caller?
Chris.
Hey, there's also Love and Sex Addicts Anonymous.
Okay.
And that is another way of going. Again, it's cost effective. It's free. And if you get a sponsor and work the step, it tends to heal some of this stuff very nicely.
How do I contact somebody for that?
Just check with the local AA.
Hey, Chris, listen, grab yourself, get yourself some help and, you know, do what you can for your friend. But if she ain't going for it, she ain't going for it. And you, part of your work is steering yourself away from helping her.
Okay, so, I mean, once I've...
that's good enough.
Yeah.
Please. I mean, Jesus Christ, we don't want to go over there. Todd?
Yeah.
You're 19.
Yeah.
What's up?
Here's what's going on. Before I even get started, hello, Adam, Drew, and to your guests.
Todd.
Hi.
Hello. Hello.
Hey.
Okay. All right.
Hey, Adam, do you figure Todd's going to last till 40? He's Todd.
Oh, you know my theory of, no man named Todd over the age of 40.
Mm-hmm.
So you're all there's no grandpa, old man Todd. There's no old miner. Would you shut up? Idiot. Jesus, people act like I don't have a button that can just cut them off. It's the best part of this job. Chelsea?
Uh-huh.
Caller goes by the name of Chelsea. You're 14.
Yeah, I have a question about herpes.
All right.
Before I lost my virginity, I've seen like this blister looking bump on me. Like down by my vagina and everything.
It wasn't herpes, though.
Well, I know, but now like they're worse or something like that. They're like more.
How old are you now?
14.
Hey, Drew.
Yeah.
Do me a favor. Grab a scratch pad there and write everyone's name and age down.
You know
please.
What? You go. You say it so quickly, and the other people talking sometimes hard for me to hear.
Grab the scratch pad anyway.
I've actually got it in front of me.
Uh-huh.
So you are sexually active now.
Mm-hmm.
And. Listen, if you're sexually active, you need to go have a pelvic exam, right? Right?
What's that?
That's where your pelvis gets examined.
Your doctor needs to go. You're at risk for cervical cancers and different diseases because you're sexually active. So it really becomes important now that you begin having regular gynecologic examinations. No, I think the probability of this being herpes is very remote. Because it's the same thing you had before you started having sex.
Well, what do you think it is, Drew?
Just like a Bartholin cyst or a sebaceous cyst, something like that. She doesn't know what herpes looks like. But it should hopefully motivate you to go in and get your regular pap smears because you need to get contraception and you need to get checked regularly if you're sexually active.
How old is the guy you're having sex with?
I'm not having sex with anybody right now.
Oh, you just had a little slip up?
I guess.
Okay. That's all right.
How old was he?
49. How old was he?
What, the last person?
Oh, okay. Oh. No, the combined age of the last two guys. 106. Okay, listen. Hey, Chelsea.
Uh-huh.
And I'm going to give this message not only out to you, but everyone who calls this goddamn show. I know you think of yourself as some sort of riddle that we want to get to the bottom of. Here's the point. We don't care. I'll hang up on your ass. Start answering questions or we hang up. That's it. I'm not interested. How old was the guy?
The guy that lost my virginity.
Okay, that's it. I don't care anymore. I don't care.
Ouch.
I've tried and tried. All right. Yes, the guy you lost your virginity to.
Okay. He was 14.
All right.
I was 12.
Ooh.
Oh,
ouch.
Now it's slipping.
It was 2 weeks before my 13th birthday.
There. Oh, well, that's better. Okay.
But it was a week before his 31st birthday, which is different because he was hopping. And what about the last guy?
The last guy? He was 15.
All right.
Well, at least you're in your ballpark. Age. Yeah, I mean,
but
that's heartening.
You do want to go and have a gynecological exam.
It's
your little rosebush, honey, and you want to take care of it.
That's right.
So.
Anyway, you got to weed and seed. Something. You got to prune. I don't know what you do. You know,
pruning is
once in a while. Someone comes over and explains what I'm supposed to do with my rose bushes.
I'm trying to be tactful.
No, I know you're using that as a euphemism for the vagina,
yes.
Which I appreciate. But I'm actually talking about my hedges. And they go, well, what you got to do is, you know, next time it rains, you got to go out at 4 a.m. and bring. Now, don't use tweezers. And it's called cross pollination. I'm always like, okay, listen, I'm going to go inside and smoke pot. Right? Whatever goes on out here. Let God do the work. All right, we will take ourselves a little break. The Trouble with Normal is the name of the show. We have most of the cast here tonight. Dr. Drew is in San Francisco doing a mediocre job, and we'll be back after this.
LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191.
I can't do this on cue. LoveLine. Okay, hold on. 94.7 NRK, the new rock alternative. Was that it?
Fantastic.
It's LoveLine.
39 kilowatts.
Oh my. It's LoveLine.
94.7 NRK.
Yeah. LoveLine, I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew in San Francisco. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. John, Larry, and Padgett are all here from The Trouble with Normal, ABC, 8:30, Friday nights, right after...
Two Guys, a Girl.
Two Guys, a Girl. Right. And then Trouble with Normal, then...
Norm.
Then...
Madigan.
Shenanigan Man. That's right.
No, I love the Irish.
Right. Sorry, swallowed some. And then 2020, right?
Is that yes. Yes.
Yeah, Friday night's my big TV night.
It was cool. I was on The View, and Barbara, Barbara Walters grabbed my hand and said, "You're going to make people watch my show, right?" Because we were sort of a lead-in. And I just felt it was great feeling the cold, clammy hand of... Barbara Walters
need.
It was actually very nice. Very nice.
Drew, you've done The View more than once, right?
Yeah.
I think I've done it once or twice. Did we do it twice?
And, I've done it about a half dozen times. And Barbara Walters is an amazing person.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, individual. She is. She is very cool. I felt thrilled to be sitting right next to her.
She wasn't there the two times I did it.
Conveniently.
Yeah. Great. But one of them liked me, right? Who
Debbie.
Liked me?
Star.
Debbie.
Oh, Debbie. Star Jones.
No, Debbie.
Oh,
who's gone now? Oh, the one who's gone?
Yeah.
As soon as she professed her love for Adam, she was fired immediately.
Yeah.
That's right.
I think just you can't hold it against somebody that they're not very bright.
No. You talking about Drew or are you talking about Debbie?
No, everybody said, oh, she's really dumb. She's really dumb. And I didn't think so, first of all.
Well, she had the good sense to be attracted to me, number one. So how dumb. Yeah. Listen, aren't they looking for a balance? I mean, they want some sort of, they wanted a sort of representation of the general populace. And let me tell you, there's plenty of stupid women out there. Uh-huh. So shouldn't you have at least one represented on your show? And don't you need one you can make fun of? See, that's the problem.
It's like the Woody Harrelson of the View.
Cheers,
she
right.
Been. Yes. Absolutely. You
and
need
here's
that.
The thing about guys. If there's a doofus guy, he's known as doofus, you know, and made fun of. Exactly. Whereas women just quietly fire them.
Hey, whereas doofus like a badge of valor.
It is true. Hey, doofus, come here. Let me use you like here. Open this beer bottle with your mouth, doofus. Good. And quit Bogarting the Cheez-Its. You think I work at the Cheez-It factory? Still? Because I did work there, but I got fired for stealing too many Cheez-Its and yelling about working, being the king of the Cheez-Its.
Line six, Adam.
All right. Sorry. How dare you interrupt my Cheez-It riff? Jackie?
Yes?
You're 18.
Yes, I am.
What's up?
My boyfriend and I have been together for 6 months, and after about 3 months, we started having sex, and we lost our virginity to each other. And in the beginning, we had sex a lot of times. All time and stuff, but now it's like he doesn't want to do it anymore, even though he likes it.
How often?
Well, we about once a week.
It's just a little below average.
How old is, well, for an 18?
He's 19.
Yeah, 19, that's well below average. And
again, is he on medications?
No, he's not.
And how long did you say you were together?
Just 6 months.
Yeah, it shouldn't be dropping this fast.
Yeah, usually that stuff's emotional. Usually that's
a woman, man, not quite so much.
Uh-huh.
Well, you see, because I used to initiate it, and he didn't like that because, like, he thought I was, like, a bit too forward in that. So I said, okay, fine, you have to initiate it. And so he's like, okay, whatever. That's when it just, like, stopped.
Yeah.
And it's like,
I tried that, too. Initiate it. And now.
Go.
I did the hand countdown in five.
Action.
Action. All right. Now, that was good for first try, but let's try the initiation again and this time have fun with it. Come on. All right. So it didn't work when you cued him to initiate.
No, I mean,
I see.
I mean, but the sex was better when he initiated it.
Sometimes you hit the person with a wicker stick and yell at them, initiate. I tend that help. That tends to help. All right, Jackie, maybe he's checking out. Maybe he's not so interested in the relationship.
I don't know. No, I don't know. Like, about 2 weeks or so before, like, our 6-month anniversary, we got in a real big fight and we almost broke up, but we ended up getting closer at the time. And then it was just kind of like, we got closer, and then he left for school, and it was just bad.
Okay. Hey, Drew,
chime in here.
Here's the deal. When you get in a relationship at 18 or 17 and a half, you have this feeling like it's supposed to go on forever.
Right.
But when it starts hitting bumps about 6 months, and they end up stretching out another year, but really, they should just sort of see the signs in the road. He's going initiating.
Yeah, you don't know how to end a relationship at 18. You don't know what the signs are. The relationship is over. You share a fantasy that's going to last forever.
Right.
And you know, if 5 years from now, you wouldn't let this relationship last 8 weeks.
Yeah, that big fight you had the other night should have ended with one of you saying, I don't think this is working anymore. But it didn't. And consequently, it's still are sort of up in the air.
But it is true, and it's weird. I mean, remember when you graduated high school, you made all these announcements that you'd be back every month to visit all the teachers. when homecoming rolls around again, you're going to be up there in the stands waving your banner and everything, and it's like that was 16 years ago or something, or 20 years ago, forget it. You think in a nostalgic way, like a preemptive nostalgia when you're 17, 18 years old. You're going to keep in touch with everyone.
Well, it's grandiose. It's omnipotent. Yeah, it's like, this is the best friend.
I'll never forget you. Yeah. It's everything's St. Elmo's fire.
Right.
It's basically, you're 19. Right. There's Hans Zimmer banging away in the background. Who the hell did that theme?
It was Parr. It was Michael Parr.
Michael Parr.
Thank you very much. Who wants to be a millionaire? I'm winning.
On his Casio in the background, and you think it's all going on forever.
Line three.
I can be a man in motion. All I need's a pair of wheels.
Yeah. That was
song
hot.
About a guy in a wheelchair. Whatever.
Julia? 19.
Julia?
Hi.
Julia?
You're 19. What's going on?
My question's for Dr. Drew.
Yeah.
I didn't have my period for like a year.
Uh-oh.
And so I went to the doctor and we got some blood tests and my hormones were all weird.
Uh-oh.
Well, my estrogen level was really low, but my pituitary was like normal. And so
did they think you have a prolactin secreting tumor?
See, he said that I have something because I got an MRI done on my head.
Right.
And I have something on my pituitary.
Right.
And he couldn't really see it because it's really small right now.
Those are called microadenomas, and they're usually prolactin secreting. But you haven't been lactating anything like that?
Drew, are you a real doctor or just a love doctor?
No, I haven't been lactating.
Okay. Well, wait a minute. Is there something that's going on inside of her skull that's creating this?
Yeah, she's got a little growth in the pituitary, and sometimes these can be controlled with medication.
Well, he said it was really common, but I wasn't, because I don't know anybody who has this problem.
It's common. It's a common medical problem. It's uncommon in the sort of out in the real world. But I would suggest you see an endocrinologist, and there are those that specialize particularly in pituitary disorders. There's a medicine called bromocriptine. If this is a prolactin secreting tumor, that sometimes when you take, they shrink right down very nicely.
Okay, honey, get a pencil. Endocrinologist.
Yeah.
E-N-D-O-C-R-I-N.
Because sometimes another
wants to be a millionaire.
Well, no, I'm just saying because he was talking so fast.
Thanks, Sean.
You were talking really fast and you were talking about it. And then the gland will secrete this, but it's prolactin and the blah, 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 blah. Right. And give the girl a chance. She's got to find an endocrinologist for crying out loud. Write it down, woman. Write it down.
Okay, I got it.
A cantaloupe sized tumor in her brain. How is she supposed to the focus.
They used to actually go after these and surgically remove them. They're less likely to do that these days.
All right. Well, they can control the medication. Julia?
Yeah.
Talk to a specialist.
Okay.
And stay
endocrine.
On it.
Gland specialist.
All right.
Well, can it cause problems with having kids later on? Because they put me on the pill, and so I have my period, but...
Yeah, like, they should be able to... No, you should be able to have restored fertility.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you.
Yeah, all right. Hey, Drew, where are those glands? All over the place?
Which ones?
I don't know. They're always checking your neck. You know what
those
I mean?
Those are lymph glands. Those are different.
And then you got the ones under your armpits, right?
Those are lymph glands. The endocrine system is not the lymphatic system. That's very different.
Well,
wait,
no,
is the pituitary gland above your ear?
No, it's right in the middle of your head, right in the middle, like behind your nose, kind of.
Nice. All right, so I could get to it with a chopstick and a 40-ouncer.
and a drill.
And a drill. That's. I don't want to give away too much, but part of the initiation of the Jackers. It has to do with the endocrine gland. It really does. All right, we're going to take ourselves a little break. We'll be right back.
We'll be right back. Call on the 1-800-LOVE-191.
This evening, Loveline is brought to you by Car Toys and the Cobalt Lounge, right here on 94.7 NRK, the new rock alternative.
Go. That is it. Another fantastic show in the can. And until next time, it's Adam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying mahalo. Where was that cello made? Oh, it was made in douche nozzle.
Well, now.
This has been Loveline. The stuff expressed on Loveline is not necessarily the stuff of the staff, management, sponsors, or anyone else, including Westwood One Entertainment. Loveline is produced by Ann Wilkins Ingold. Now, please enjoy these birds.